Hello, it is the Chromemagnus. How are you chaps doing anyway? I hope you're all very well. And as promised, here is my setting review of Deadlands, the Weird West. Or basically more of a setting recap, to be perfectly honest. Deadlands, the Weird West, as you might have gathered, through some mystical fairy whispering in your ear, yeah, it actually takes place in the Weird West. It was a role-playing game that was designed by a group called Pinnacle Entertainment, which, I don't know, you probably call them that, they say they're on the fringes maybe, but in recent years, I mean, technically speaking, the older, more experienced role players in any group will probably have heard and or played the Deadlands setting, and they've got some other settings besides. Anyway, I really, really find the Deadlands setting very interesting. Not because, as everybody's instantly going to assume that, yeah, well, in actual fact, that in the original game, what you actually did is you used poker chips for something or other. I actually can't quite remember the details, but you actually used a deck of cards, a deck of real playing cards, to A, sort out the initiative orders, which was just awesome. But even better than that was there was a caster class, a magic caster class. Basically, it was like a trickster called a huckster. And what he did is that whenever he cast a spell, he would basically play a simplified game of po excuse me, a simplified game of poker with one of these evil spirits called a joker that were actually something else entirely. Well, they called them a joker anyway. And they played a simplified game of poker just to see how good the hand is and how well they cast the spell. That's awesome. That's fantastic. But what really appeals to me is the fact that, it is basically set in the real world, in our world, but the history is sort of divergent. So at a particular point, it just goes cuckoo, cuckoo. It just goes completely off the wall. So essentially, the game itself is set in 1877. So the American Civil War is still raging, but not quite for the reasons that it was raging in the first place. Okay, so basically, in sorry, and I'm looking left to see stuff because I had to sort of create some notes because this is more of a history lesson than just a setting review, to be honest. So in 1863, a Susquehanna. I hope. I think that's the name of them. Basically, the Indians still have a very strong presence in this as well. Oh, and incidentally, just before I go on, what I really like, and I haven't really seen this in history textbooks, perhaps because I'm not American, I don't know, but this is referenced in Mage the Awakening as well, as one of the major plots. So I'm assuming that this is actually, that this, or something similar to this actually happened. In 1863, a Susquehanna shaman named Raven promised a reckoning to the white people who sort of ravaged the land, come in, stolen all their resources, all that stuff. And he began forming the Last Sons, who were basically a band of young shamans and braves, who were also very discontent with white man sort of bullying in onto the land and all this sort of stuff. So what they did, to actually make good this promise, is they travelled to basically, I might be getting this completely wrong because this could be, Native American sort of history that I'm completely butchering. They travelled to the hunting grounds. Now, the hunting grounds in the Reckoning, it's more like a plane of spirits. It's not actually a physical place, as far as I can gather. It's more like a twilight or a shadow world that's sort of in the ether around this one. So it's there, but we just can't see it and we can't make contact with it, this kind of thing. It could be the fact that that's their afterlife. I really don't know. It might be actually, but. So anyway, he travelled to the hunting grounds through the Mi'kmaq burial grounds, which are sacred to the Native American Indians, and basically, the older and wiser sort of shamans attempted to stop the Last Sons. They themselves were just cut down, cast aside, and Raven entered the hunting grounds. And when he was in there, he unleashed a group of very powerful demonic spirits, I suppose, called the Manitou. And not only that, but he awakened the big bad boogeymen, the really big nasty demons called the Reavers. And basically, what it turns out is the Manitou are essentially the pawns of the Reavers, and I'll go into those in a moment. Now, he returned in the same year, in 1863, and when he returned, he gets a bit freaky from this point. 5,000 Union troops, the Union being the North, the Confederacy being the South, 5,000 Union troops in New Orleans are mysteriously slain, and certain scientists of the time start to just dream up these new and incredible images of machinery and devices that, you know, are way beyond the bounds of technology at that particular time. The Pinkertons, who are the agents of the North, and the Rangers, who are the peacekeepers of the South, go figure, Texas Rangers, I might add, realise a lot more horror sightings from that point on. People talking about sort of monsters and creepy crawlies and what that stuff, you know, and stuff that they've seen around the Weird West. And these guys clock onto the fact that it's actually the higher the level of uncertainty and fear is in the different areas around the different cities, the more chance there is of these horrible sightings. And then, of course, to make matters even worse, in 1864, the Civil War flares right back up because Abraham Lincoln is assassinated. So there you go, in brief, is sort of the events that lead to this whole thing. But there's one last event. In 1868, Raven returns. And what he does, he pisses off the ancestral spirits of the Native American Indians around California. Don't ask me how he got all the way west, I don't know, but he did. And basically, he cast some magics to piss them off. He started a minor tremor. And being the suckers that they are, the old earth elementals and the spirits and whatnot took the bait, and they amplified it. So in the end, California isn't really there anymore. It's basically hit the drink big time. Basically, everything shattered, and it created what was known as the Great Maze. And yeah, so essentially, the Great Maze, you know, a lot of new horrors. Excuse me. People that mined the Great Maze found a new type of rock. It was very unearthly, and basically when it burnt, you could hear the shrieks of dead, deceased souls. But, being humans, they basically, it burns 5 times longer than coal. No, beg your pardon. It's one way or the other. I think it's 100 times hotter than coal, and 5 times longer. Might be the other way around. In fact, it probably is. So essentially, amazing energy source. And of course, then the Confederacy goes in and says, well, we own this now. And the Union says, well, no, you don't, piss off. And that starts the Great Rail Wars. So, you know, the Civil Wars just kick up big time, not because of racial differences, simply because of this new fuel source, really. You know, the racial differences thing is only there as a backbone. It's like most religious wars. It's not because of religion, it's because of something else, or religion's just the excuse and all that stuff. So yeah, that is the history, really, of Deadlands. And you basically play somebody trying to get by, maybe trying to stop the horror, whatever. I'm sorry, I'm going to have to be quick now. Yes, now, setting, basically, what this ghost rock allows people to do, and it's particularly mad scientists, is to create sort of giant mechanical machinery. And at the very, essentially, if you've seen Will Smith's Wild Wild West, and you remember the giant tarantula at the end, that is like, basically, it is that. You know, that is it perfectly. And not only that, but they've actually found ways to create zombies, and basically the Reavers just basically get the Manitou to up the fear levels in areas so that, and because the fear nourishes them. That's what they like fear. It's basically like their food source. They're basically farming fear. And, you know, the Manitous can possess corpses and turn them into re-deads. That's not the name. And, you know, it can also possess people, turn them into zombies. So you've got, it's basically a horror setting in the Wild West, in the Wild West. And quite frankly, if you're interested in it, I would suggest having a look. As you may have heard in my GURPS review, I picked up basically what was essentially the second edition of The Weird West. Well, it's not really, but it ran under GURPS. It was the second edition they released, only to realise that there is now Deadlands Reloaded, running under the system of the Scavenger Worlds that I could have picked up instead, which is so much better. Anyway, just before I run out of time completely, that was your setting recap stroke review of Deadlands The Weird West, with me, Chromemagnus. So anyway, I shall catch you guys later. I will at some point do a system review. Expect that to be hilarious, I hope. And yeah, I shall catch you guys later, and I'm probably going to do a setting review of The World of Darkness. Catch you then. Cheers.